just going to explain to you how the evening's going to go. It's in three parts. We had the first part, which was Stretch and Evan in the studio. We're going to do a panel, and then after that, we're going to have three legendary club DJs doing DJ sets. So don't leave after the panel. We're going to have Jazzy Nice, Hex Hector, and the one and only Clark Kent as well. So I get the honor of quickly introducing these guys. And if we add up how long I've known them all for, it's going to be a long time. So, Stretch Armstrong, New York legend. He's been collecting flyers since he was came onto the scene in the 80s. I knew him as Adrian B back then. And he went on not only to become one of New York's greatest DJs, but also set up a radio show with Stretch Bobbito, which Source called the greatest hip-hop show ever. And they made the movie, which you guys need to see, and most recently, him and Evan put the book together. Evan Allback, who is an archivist and also co-author of the book, is probably the most sought-after hip-hop archivist around and has been responsible for really bringing back a lot of the stuff that we need to know about this period of music in the 90s. He's one of the most knowledgeable people you'll know on the subject. Next to him, everyone's a legend sitting down, but next to him is what I call a lifer in the club business, Steve Lewis. I think I first met him when he very nicely let me into the world a long time ago. Steve was responsible for the Limelight, Club USA, Life, Butter. I mean, he's done pretty much everything from running clubs to designing clubs and even DJing clubs in New York. Steve Lewis. Yeah. Next to Steve is Bill Spector. Bill has been doing clubs since the late 80s. He had a legendary party called Sheets and Pillows, amongst other things, and also gave a young Mark Ronson his first start. So Bill is still doing it club-wise as well. Next to Bill is Jessica Rosenblum. I think Jessica is more responsible for, one of those people who's so responsible for the development of hip-hop in New York. Without her, the early parties with P. Diddy, Daddy's House, The Tunnel, Funkmaster Flex, Jessica is a legend. Dee Dee came from London in the late 80s and started a party called Deep, and for those of you who remember it, and then went on to really help develop rave culture in this country with the legendary club NASA. And then after that, was responsible for bringing jungle to the United States. DB is also a designer, so a lot of the flyers you'll see from him, he actually designed. And then finally, the legendary DJ Clark Kent. Clark's crew, besides being one of the greatest DJs in New York, in the world. Clark's crew were called the Superman, and then that's how he got the name Clark Kent. And he's made tracks with Biggie and Jay-Z, and is going to be playing later as an absolute legend. So, thank you guys. Enjoy.
It's a beautiful day out, thanks to global warming. It's great to see so many familiar faces and so many unfamiliar faces. This feels like Facebook for old people. Anyway, this is a trip because amongst this panel, I see people that I did my first club with, people that wouldn't give me jobs for years. Jessica, who let me into Nell's when I was 18 years old, and to this day I don't know why she did, but my life probably would have ended up taking a much different turn if I couldn't get in there and see the magic that was my favorite club of all time. I was too young to go to many of the clubs that Clark Kent snuck into and even worked at as a teenager. Anyway, this is we're not trying to get too deep here. This book came about because Evan and I, we met through Instagram, and you know, hip hop kind of brought us together. And as we became friends, we decided we wanted to do a project. At the time, I was sort of going through all my stuff and realized that these flyers, which I've been keeping since 1988, I've really aged into something that to me feels special. And I think it was your idea to put them into a book, because I think my idea was to blow them all up and put them on a wall, which I couldn't invite all of you to my house, so that would have been selfish and useless. So the book, the idea came about in that way, and it took a long time, a lot of hard work. I think one of the beautiful things about the book, which is now extended into these types of events, is meeting people that we may not have spoken to as a little younger, that I may not have seen since I was actually in some of these clubs, and just having these conversations with people that you may have seen on a weekly basis in nightclubs. I see Kim Harris.
We've talked outside of
nightclubs. I know, but I see clubs a lot. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
It's a good thing. That's a good thing. Nightlife in New York City in the late 80s and early 90s was, to me, so good that you really could go out four or five nights a week, and do that week to week. That would be an anomaly. Anyway, we finished the book and we've been doing events like this. This is by far the most attended. So thank you, Morris, thank you, Giant Step, and thank you, Samsung. There's so many angles that we could start with, but I think I'm gonna kick it over to Steve Lewis now. Certainly you didn't, what? I guess just a general question, like what, in the late 80s, early 90s, like what does that mean to you now, looking back?
Well, first of all, I wanna make sure that everybody knows that I'm here to make New York City nightlife great again. I guess the 80s and 90s were a blur, so it must have been great. I didn't sleep for two decades. I was thrown in jail. I had a great time. No regrets. It was a time when people of diverse backgrounds got together and party in clubs. We didn't have to worry about what bathrooms we were going to use. There was no such thing as gay or straight. I mean, it was, but we didn't think about it in the terms that we think about it today. There were no issues inside the clubs. The clubs were sanctuaries, and the music was diverse. There were seven dance floors in one of my clubs going on at the same time. So we were able to appeal to all different types of people, rich, poor, black, white, everything, and they all got along. Well, not all the time, but... But we had a great time, and I think we made history.
Yeah. Okay. Just go down the line. Down the line. There will stand there.
I'm not a good speaker, but I'll put it in anyway. For me, clubs, as my friend Dante eloquently said the other day, it was essentially our internet. We went to Washington Square Park during the day, and then we went to the clubs at night, and that's how we met people. We saw our lane, who we wanted to hang out with, who we didn't get along with, who we liked, who we wanted to make advance to, who we wanted to walk away from, who we wanted to do business with. Now, it's much different. People just do it only on their phone. We actually interacted with each other, and it was a very interesting time.
Yeah. In the late 80s, early 90s in nightlife, and I've said this before, you know, it wasn't a regulated business the way it is now. So it wasn't about real estate, bottle service, and the pay to get in. So it was exciting. It was the Wild Wild West. And that's why so many creative and interesting people were part of the scene, because it wasn't some predictable, regulated situation. And so in turn, it became so exciting because you never knew who you were going to meet. It could be an incredible artist or a graffiti artist or a singer or, you know, sitting next to an heiress, sitting next to some kid who just come here from the Midwest. So it was a mishmash, not only the music, but the people. And the people were interesting. Now, I mean, you go to the club, like, shoot me, I don't want to walk anybody.
You could get shot back in the day if you wanted to. It was optional.
You know, and certain scene, what was interesting is for a while, in certain clubs, you know, they were welcoming of all kinds and all genres of music. Or as Steve said, there was many different, you know, floors or levels or rooms, and that's not something that you would really find now unless somebody, you know, marketed and promoted a super club or something. But I think when I really started only doing hip-hop, it also was exciting because it was new and it was cutting edge and it was underground and I was giving it an outlet downtown and it hadn't been accessible downtown prior to.
And on that scale.
Yeah, like Bill, I'm really uncomfortable talking in public, but I'll give it a go.
But you look amazing.
Thank you. You know, I became a promoter because I couldn't get gigs playing what I wanted to play in established clubs. So, musically, it was just the most exciting time I've ever experienced. The creativity that was going on in all the non-genres, was just like nothing else we've ever seen since. So that, to me, was what it was all about. The promoting of the parties, I got my creative buzz from designing the flyers and doing the visuals inside, but mostly it was just about DJing. And that's really cool.
Well,
so far, you're a designer flyer.
Yes. Won't do it again. For me, if I look at the late 80s, early 90s, before I even say what I'm going to say, I want to say something to Jessica, about Jessica Rosenblum. This guy right here had bomb parties, super underground, shit is out of control. Jessica Rosenblum used to be at the door at Nell's and was shit on everybody. I'm not kidding. Like, I was a well-known playing club DJ, and I would get in, and then next week I wouldn't get in. And then I would get in, and next week I would get in. And you didn't care, because if you got in one time, it was golden. When she started doing what she was doing, everything changed. This is probably the most important party promoter that New York City has ever seen for clubs, period. I'm saying that to say she said what she did for hip-hop. When you went and played for Jessica, I played for Jessica probably more than anybody except for Funkmaster Flex, because she managed Funkmaster Flex. So that's just the way it's gonna happen. But I played for her before she met Flex. I was the guy she had all the time. So I was her first hip-hop DJ. But I didn't play hip-hop. I played music. So when she had a club, yeah, she let the hip-hoppers in. But they were hearing house, they were hearing rock, they were hearing everything, because there was no such thing as a kind of club. It was Jessica's party. And you wanted to go to Jessica's party. Now, if I look at the 80s, it was a blur. I did every damn party, so whatever. And it was the shit. That's all I got. But Jessica Rosenblum is the real goddamn deal.
So we'll move back here, and I'll start with you, Clark, as it pertains to the flyers and the nightclubs. It would be good to get a little bit of an anecdote from everybody coming down the line, but for you specifically, the experience of seeing your name on a flyer, whether it was next to somebody who you aspired to be or when you headlined, talk about something that people might not know.
From 88 on, respectfully, I was the headliner. So I never aspired to be anybody on the flyer. And all I cared, and Jessica can tell you this true, is DJ in front of my name, because I didn't want to be Clark Kent on the fly. I wanted to be DJ Clark Kent, because everything that I am is because I'm a DJ first. Yeah.
Is that big enough?
Notice where the name is. I mean, I'm not trying to sound the way, but I've been DJing since I was 9. So when the 80s was here, I was old already in a club. And I had opened plenty of clubs, and Red Alert changed my life. But that was before this time. When my Red Alert changed my life, you can forget it. I was never opening again. And
you hold the distinction as the only DJ that was really championed by Marley Marl and Red Alert. And that doesn't deserve a comment. That's just incredible.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, put them on for the 1 a.m. prime time in Union Square. That's before this book, before I was going out. And he DJed on In Control for Marley Marl, WBLS. That's not an easy feat.
All right, Evie, talk about the flyer experience. Talk about, as a designer, in an era where, I guess, the logo flipping kind of style that you took today is very accepted and appreciated, valued, or looked to as part of the streetwear culture, but you were so ahead of your time in doing that.
Yeah, I mean, it was just appreciation of art. My mum was very artistic, and I grew up with beautiful sort of pictures on walls. Andy Warhol influenced me with the soup can thing, and that was the first time I sort of thought about, you know, a product being a piece of art. So when I came to do, I guess the Nike Deep was the first time. Is that there? Yeah. The Nike Deep was the first time I put a logo into a flyer. And we flipped it because there was air conditioning that week. So we put Nike air conditioning. But the whole thing was just about creativity for me. I mean, it still is. I get any kind of satisfaction I get from life is because of people being creative, or me being creative. I wish, you know, I became a DJ because I was a frustrated rock star. I became a flyer designer because I was a frustrated artist. I'm not really those things, but I tried, you know, so it's just about, you know, having a go.
How about you, Jess? I know that we've had conversations where you actually designed some of your flyers, and you describe them as just being ends to a means as a vehicle, but I don't really know if you know how underappreciated that style of design is and important to what you had going on.
Well, I think in the beginning, I was designing the flyers just out of necessity because I couldn't afford a designer or somebody to do it. And I do think that they sort of mirror the time and the culture. And if you look at the evolution of my flyers over time, the style of the flyers changed with all the styles of, you know, that were going on in hip hop and on the street and in the club and street fashion, etc. I don't think, I mean, almost by default, some of my early flyers now look very styly, but it wasn't due to my great graphic skills. and a lot of times I just co-opted images or things I could find or phrases and sort of, so I always took the marketing standpoint, I think, for the flyers. But I do like the way they look now.
All right, Bill, chime in, Cheeks and Pillows. Let's talk about the flyers, let's talk about the
worst flyers ever.
The party.
We made them in Kinko's. For me, I didn't come from a design perspective. I didn't come from anywhere. I actually just wanted access to promote it, like Jessica said. And later on when we did parties with Jessica, she actually controlled how we made the flyers. Like, I don't, at the hundreds of parties I did with her, I don't ever think I made one of them. And because for me, I just really wanted them to be done and to be in everybody else's club and bombarding them. And I knew I'd done a good job when my friends and peers had thrown me out of the club. Because I didn't know how to bomb their club. I went from a graffiti writer, so I took a graffiti writer's mentality. Every person was getting a flyer until they were sick of getting a flyer from me.
So who did the Mac Daddy's flyer? This is the shortest lived incredible party.
Grand opening, grand closing.
Ever.
Well, the early flyers were done by Hugh, and then after, when they became graphically interesting, all the secondary flyers were done by Eric Cologne, who was an amazing designer. So I wish I could take credit for them, but I don't. I would look at them and I would say they're great, they're grammatically right, and I get them. This party, we had a great party. come to Mac Daddy's, and it got shut down the same night. 3 a.m, some of our friends fought some of our other friends, and it was pretty interesting. And the police thought there was a shootout. Only a skateboard.
He's being politically correct. There were some very prominent people who are extremely active in the world today.
So an interesting question I want to pose to you, Steve, and we had this very quick conversation, is the economy of the flyer distribution. You know, talk about how the mechanics of, you know, today with the internet, you have a party, you put it on Facebook, you put it on Instagram, but there was an economy there. There was people who were paid, and they had a certain quota that they had to deliver. Talk a little bit.
I had teams of people who would work street corners, Ham Alley, vent through them on the street so people would pick them up. But then we had the real specialty flyers, and no credit, I guess, has been given to Gregory Holmes, who was the graphic designer that I used mostly for my big invites. I tell a story. I mean, I was always looking for interesting flyers, something that would be a flyer, trinkets in stores. And one day at the flea market, they used to have on 6th Avenue and 28th Street, I guess, I bought 1,000 test tubes, not knowing what I would do with them. And what I did is it was a DJ's birthday, and I printed on the acetate clear, "You're invited," and I filled it with yellow liquid, put the stopper on, hand distributed. We had our teams hand distributed. But at that time, Michael Alley was one of my assistants, so he insisted and did. It took about 100 test tubes, and it really peed in them. So some special people actually got, "You're invited."
Yeah,
it was war.
And actually, Gregory was extremely helpful in compiling this book. And so we gave all the credit we could.
Yeah,
and he actually sat on a panel with us a few months ago.
At the World, he printed money for us. We had money that could not be counterfeited. I got the idea when I went to Disneyland. I came home with $20-something worth of pieces of paper for souvenirs. So we printed money that we would give people. Instead of drink tickets, we'd say, "Here, you can buy whatever you want with this," and then people would buy them to take them home as souvenirs. So we were making money by selling paper. And
was it your party that Gregory did the crack vials for?
Yeah, that was no intende. That was my thing. Gregory, we took a Tums and put it in a crack vial, and the party was no intende and said, "Just say no intende."
He told on our last panel the difficulty that he had buying hundreds of crack vials.
Yeah, we had to send out teams to buy small amounts at a time. We had at one point 166,000 names on our mailing list. So we would send out 60,000 flyers or 50,000 flyers, and we would divide it up into zip codes where this person attended an art party, which was mostly gay, and we had really good people. So the science of the flyer, which is, of course, has been lost, but should come back, because I think people want to get something to hand. But we used to hand out a flyer in the beginning, and somebody got an invitation to a party, they'd say, "Wow, this is great." And mostly after a period of time, they had so many flyers from so many people, they just ended up on the floor. But that's what we're talking about back in the old days.
Can I make a point?
Yeah, if you can make the point while we look at what I think is one of your best flyers ever. Yes. Can you see that?
My point was really quickly.
I'm DJing pictures.
You know, Steve, at a large club or organization, and with a guest list, a mailing list of 160,000 divided up, we were doing the same thing on a smaller scale. So even weekly for the tunnel, I would have 6 interns in my office stuffing envelopes and sitting there in postage, and there it was a weekly ritual, the run up to the post office and the stamps, and obviously replaced by the internet now, but absolutely necessary component of promoting back then. And a big deal, and including the staff at the parties that kept updated mailing lists and would get the information. It's just a different way of, you know, curating and quantifying the way now it would be done with, like, you know, an email blast and then the click-throughs, etc. And it was a big part of the expense that you factored in. It's not like you could get discount postage.
Was there something about actually, I mean, there are two things we're talking about. We're talking about clubs that were really big, that had budgets to really carpet bomb, not necessarily, maybe that's the wrong term, but really invite a lot of people. But for smaller clubs and mid-sized clubs where a promoter really wanted to make sure the right mix of people were there, wasn't the flyer a much more effective tool back then? And I guess the question is that I'd like to pose to everybody is, with the internet and the convenience that has brought in, what have we given up?
Filter. Anybody can access, you don't know.
Just texture, depth.
Use the mic, or talk loudly.
Can I say something? You just don't have something in your hand. It's mental, it's whatever it is on the internet, it's gone, it's flat. You used to hold the flyer, you used to carry around, you'd show your friends, and it felt important that you got this flyer. We gave that up.
Gave up being human. You're not a person anymore. Now you're just this digits. And you get this thing on your phone, and you pay attention to it, and you don't. You got a flyer. You actually wanted to read it. Now it's on your phone. You can get it later.
It added to the excitement and the anticipation. Like, this was a big, annual thing.
And there was an aspect of word of mouth, too. You know, for Deep, we were only printing 500 flyers at Kinko. We just gave them to the people that we cared about. And somehow Dante got one.
It's funny, like, we're looking at this picture of Jessica's Nickelback Lounge, and we took the flyer, I guess we were doing Party Against Her at that point, and co-opted into a party that me and Leslie Bernard were doing, and we put a Nickelback, we put hypothetically something in there, we put a piece of gum, a condom, a rolling paper, and the flyer, and it said, ingredients for a good evening. And we gave out them, and nobody's ever found one from them. I guess everybody used them. Hopefully.
Sure, I could talk about the flyers a little bit more. Let's talk about the idea that these flyers at the time were these disposable items or invites. Did you think 30 years, 25 years later, that there would be something to be made available of? You know, some of the collections that we've taken in DB, some of the stuff you gave us, but people discarded them.
Yeah, I don't know why they're not in the MoMA yet. Joking.
How about you, Jessica? I know you saved a lot of your flyers. Like, what was your reason behind holding on to these things?
I think I was proud of them, and I was proud of the events and the success and what they represented. And I also, aesthetically, I liked the way they all looked together and the story they told, you know, over time. In the beginning, it was just sort of happenstance, I would chuck a batch here that I didn't use, and then I started realizing how many events I was doing and the volume, and you know, it just seemed to make sense to hang on to some of each one. And also later, when I had other designers like Gregory, who we mentioned, and other people, you know, they were creating really incredible invites. They were almost like, you know, pieces of art. But I felt that they represented something I would, even if it was for nobody else, for me, I would want to see it in 10, 20 years.
Were you a flyer keeper, or are you a collector of things?
Crazy enough, I don't collect sneakers, I just like them a lot. But I did back in the days, but then I kind of didn't anymore, and I didn't because I didn't know it was history. I just knew that's where I work. So like, most people go to clubs and they're going to party. Every time I go to a club, I'm going to work. So I didn't look at it the same way. You know what I'm saying? I really didn't hang out much. And if I did, I went to a club that people didn't want to go to. I went to the Garage every weekend. And yes, it was a thoroughly gay club, but I was as straight as 6 o'clock, but it was the best club I'd ever been to. So I went there every week. I never hung out anywhere else. So I went there so I could learn more about music. So when I was on flyers, you know, it was cool for a day, 3, 4, 5, 6 days, but then next week there's a new one, and I just gotta keep working. So it was different for me, but I did understand it when you started telling me that you're doing this book. I was like, damn, I threw away so much of what would be called history. You know, because they really were a piece of history.
I think more than anyone, perhaps with the exception of Steve, you lived history. And after we met at Mars, 89 and 90. At that point, I had not known even one DJ personally. And I went to your mom's crib in Brooklyn. And your bedroom should be in the Smithsonian. It's the tags on that wall from, it's like, Ultramagnetic, Biz, Rakim, Kane, Karis. I mean, everybody was in your crib. Bananas. And that room still exists, right?
Yeah.
Gotta talk to your mom. You know, conversation. Because you don't care.
You know, one of the interesting things that we had talked about when designing the book itself was, do we supplement some of these flyers with images of the club scene, what it looked like, and that was difficult to find, you know, because, and these flyers tell the story. You know, today it's so acceptable that you go to the club, Instagram, you Snapchat, you do that, but this was a time for people who weren't there, that was not an acceptable thing to have a camera up in your face. It was private.
The thing is that there were cameras, it's just that you didn't have time because you were partying. Now you go to the club to tell everybody you're at a party,
yes.
Which is whack.
Before the internet, you could not show up to Nell's and be like, oh, hi, this is the camera around my neck, I'm gonna get in. Like, that's just not happening.
There's too much happening in clubs for you to take a camera in anyway.
You could go to any party unless you were a approved photographer. And I think, you know, that made clubs private, made them, to use your word, sanctuaries. And I think that, I mean, the reason why Nell's is so dear to my heart is because as a young man, I was just too inhibited to dance. But when you went to Nell's, everybody got busy because the dance floor was pitch black. It was private and intimate, and no one was gonna take your picture, no one was gonna shine a light on you. And I think that can be said, for the most part, for clubs until pocket phones with cameras came about. And I think that really, you know, I don't like complaining about how things were better than they are now. I think for the most part, they're just different. But the privacy that we've given up, I think is something, I think that's a real issue. Probably many of us have been to events where they've actually confiscated your phone, you've got to put it in one of those packs, you've got to put a sticker over the camera, and I think that's just good policy, and I'd like to see more of that. So maybe we'll do a party where we have physical invites and no phones.
Well, you've given me a moment.
Talking to you?
Yeah, well, we do a party. Me, Stretch, D-Nice, Rich Medina, Stretch Armstrong, and Tony Touch, called The Originals. This party is so ill that you can't find pictures of it on the internet. That's when you know your party's ill.
Yeah.
You can't. I challenge you to find 10 pictures of each party of The Originals. You can show that to me, you're amazing. You can't, because our party's too good. We want a party. So we do our party so people can party. If you're taking pictures, you're kind of whack.
Don't be whack.
March 16th. Right? March
16th. So, I want to hear from everyone, with the exception of the parties that you were, or clubs that you were responsible for, what were your favorite events, clubs, parties that you were not officially affiliated with?
Anything Suzanne Bosch ever did. I just want to say that I think New York nightlife could be as good as it ever was. I think we just have to build a wall between Bushwick and Williamsburg. I think the Williamsburgers pay for it. I think that Suzanne Bosch, I don't know if you people know who she was, but everything she ever did, not one exception, has been phenomenal. I've worshipped her since the day I met her. We fought wars, but she's the best there ever was. So anytime I could take a day off, I mean, I never took a day off or a night off, I would sneak out of my places, leave the 4,000 people having fun, to go to her event. It was just better than what I was doing. And she's great, and she's still doing it.
Yeah. And what about her parties? I think there are probably a lot of people who have no idea what her parties are about.
People got dressed 2 weeks in advance. They spent their paychecks and whatever, their prostitution money, on their outfits just to get ready. And it was a diverse crowd. And again, it was mixed, all types of people. And the music was always interesting, something you weren't hearing at every other club. And I don't have to tell you that. I just go to a Suzanne Barsh party. She has one this week, I'm sure. And she's still there. And she's old. I think she's a year older than me, or a year younger. So, you know, she's still doing it.
On the nights that I wasn't at Mel's, I would often go to Payday or to Deep or to one of Bill's parties, but I would also go to Suzanne's parties. And I think something that's part of this era that's so special is all these events that we're talking about ran concurrent. And they were all so different and so interesting, so you had so many options. So if you club hop now, you're going to three of the same parties on the same night. Club hop then, it was an amazing experience. And, you know, I could be at Nell's, and then I could maybe go see Clark, or then I could go to, you know, see Bill. I mean, you would just, there was so much choice.
I think that's actually a good word. I mean, as well, you know, I went to the Fun House. I learned about like big DJs. I got to see somebody like Jelly Bean and thousands of people dancing to him, and it was amazing. And then later on, I went to places like Danceteria, which I didn't understand at that point. But looking back, you know, opened my eyes to a lot of different cultures, to scenes, to like Bambata, to like punk rock, all stuff that I didn't really know. Even when I went to DB's parties, like I went to his raves and I was like, what is this crazy music and renting the hip hop room? And then slowly the music became endearing upon me and it made me learn and grow. And obviously I have a kin to Jessica because we did hundreds of parties together, and Stretch was my DJ, Clark was my DJ. And then I worked for Steven on and off when he didn't fire me for years. But each one made me grow a little bit more and learn.
I also think people didn't have a mental mentality of like, I can only go hear this kind of music and it has to be this scene. You were just open. There was so much variety and you didn't think it was wrong to go learn or experience something new, which now everybody's terrified of.
The two clubs that inspired me to become a promoter, I actually never got to.
Paradise Garage
and The Area. Yeah, sorry, not The Area. Area.
But you could call it Areas too.
But I was lucky enough to be able to throw NASA in the space that was Area, so I was like, this is for sanctioned ground. that was, you know, incredible room. As far as going to, yeah, I mean, once I became established as a DJ, I got booked in other places and started to come work for me too. So I stopped collecting flyers at that point too. But there's one gig that I remember going to, which was in Puerto Rico, and I was just talking to one of the guys here about it. It was on the side of a rainforest. It's a rave, full-on, like, crazy rave. But it was the most beautiful setting I've ever been to. My wife was pregnant with our first child, and the bass, we thought she was going to miscarry. Because the bass was just so intense. But that was a special gig. Yes.
Like I said, I was usually working, but if I wasn't working, I went to every club that Larry Levan DJed in, or Timmy Richards, and Melvin Bob DJed in. That was it. That's what I did. I followed.
There were after-hours clubs, and yeah. That's what we're not talking about. Clubs did, when all of us worked. So I was working till 4, I had to check out, count the money, make sure I made $1 million. And then we would go to after hours clubs. And I would get there at 6 o'clock in the morning and the party was still starting. It was just starting. And that's what we did. And these were after hours clubs that held 2,000, 3,000 people. And I mean, they were, it's just the Paradise Garage. I told the story about the garage that I went there once with a bunch of my friends and they hated it, so I got new friends. It was that. It changed my life. It wasn't me, but it changed. Like it wasn't you, but it changed my life. It was that good. That these parties were going on until you walk out of a party at noon, 1 o'clock, 2 in the afternoon, and I think about it. You know, I changed my clothes and worked. At one point, I doubled up. I worked other jobs and put on a suit and be in the office at 9 o'clock in the morning. You know, and go back to the club.
we were kind of limited with how many images we could project up here. So, I mean, the book we do have, I mean, the Save the Robots flyers, and for some reason the NASA flyers aren't here, which is too bad because they're fantastic, but they're in the book.
But Frank Szabo, who co-designed half the flyers, is somewhere up there, so give him a shout out. Yeah.
Where are we at for time right now? Anyone know?
Looks like 20 minutes. We want to give about 15 minutes
for Morris, you know, you organize this, but you played such a pivotal role in 90s club life with Giant Step, which is now this fancy brand. But really, was an integral part of the fabric of New York City nightlife. We were talking in the green room about when you started Giant Step and how it took 6 months for it to take off, and that it probably wasn't a good idea that you started on the same night as Soul Kitchen. We do have some Soul Kitchen flyers. Jack Luber, half of the Soul Kitchen crew, was trying to make it, but he couldn't catch a flight from Hawaii. And it's funny because, you know, we were talking about how if you look at everyone on this panel and a lot of people here, we you know, it seems like we do a lot of very different things within the cultural realm. But if you trace our lineage back to 1990, we were all part of a very small family of people. And a lot of us ended up at Soul Kitchen every week, which was, you know, maybe 50, 60 people. Deep was a little bit bigger, but, you know, like Davey said, they printed 500 copies and most of those people showed up and everybody knew each other. And I think Giant Step kind of worked on the same principle. It was like a family affair, right?
Yeah, very much a family affair. And we were very influenced by Soul Kitchen. That's how we started the Groove Academy, because Cranky was playing old soul records. And I knew that these guys were still alive, so I decided to go and find them and put on shows with people like Maceo and Bootsy and George Clinton. But, you know, Giant Step, it was a family thing. It wasn't just about, you know, Jonathan and myself who started it. It was a family. And this flyer actually predates Giant Step, when I actually used to do things under my name. And it's, funnily enough, DB was on this bill. There's a DJ called Adrian B.
Eric's cousin.
Jazzy Nice, who's standing over there. This is 25 years ago, by the way. And a guy called Moby, who we never knew who he was back then, but he went on to do some stuff. And then the greatest DJ of them all, who's up there, Mr. Mark Kamen, rest in peace, who is a New York, was a New York legend. And also DJ Smash, who was from Save the Robots. And a couple of months after that, Jazzy and Smash started Giant Step with me. So yeah, it was a family thing, yeah.
Did you pick this image of the Buddha? Because for some reason, people just always think the Buddha means it's gonna be some kind of exotic, hedonistic affair. Why is that?
You put this flyer in the book. I'd actually forgotten about this. So I can't remember. You used to use jazz cover.
Yeah, just to see if we have time or how much time we need. Raise your hand if you think you want to ask a question. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 questions. Should we take questions?
Yeah, let Ray go first.
I'm a hard copy dude, so I'm still promoting.
That means that's a question meaning, will you come to my event?
I don't like it, I love it.
How were the flyers designed? This is before computers were accessible and printers were easily accessible. So how did you get the images, the coloring, all of that?
Let's have DB, since he's the most official designer up here. Stop it, you are.
The deep flyers were literally drawn by hand. and then Tipex out, what do you call Tipex, white out, and then Xerox, black and white, white to black. I did the flyer once, and then each week I would change the date and white out, and it was just a horrible mess. And as the year went on, they became more grainy and more messy. By the time we got to NASA, computers and Kinko existed, so Mike and I used to go to Kinko's every Tuesday.
It's a digital bird.
We go to the Kinko's and sit till 3 or 4 a.m. working on these. I think we went to somewhere in the 30s. I don't remember which one. Mike, where was the Kinko's we went to?
That's
in 30 seconds. That's right. No man's.
As we used to call upstate New York.
Yeah, and we'd stay there every week, and we have to come up with a product to flip for NASA. It's a shame you can't show the flyers. But basically, there was a year's worth of a different product every week. It's quite a challenge.
Amazing. Yeah, people have asked us why the book stops in 99, and actually most of the flyers end in 95. There were a few from 99, so we changed the title. But I felt that the more advanced technology got, the less idiosyncratic, the less special the flyers were. I mean, some of my favorite flyers are the ones that are done with Xerox and tape, and even some of the ones that were done on some of those really early computer programs, like one of Jessica's.
Can you go to the page that's like all the top flyers?
That one.
Yeah, I did all these on some simple computer program, and then, you know, didn't really know what I was doing, printing it out and pasting it up and going to Kinko's, and some of them were at the actual printer. That wasn't the page I meant, but okay.
I can get you any page you want. Shall we go to Powerhouse? Boom. This is a flyer that Eric Hayes designed Friday, May 18th. DJ Clark Kent and Mantronics. Not bad. Not bad. He was working. Just a night of work. Just another night of work. Any more questions? Microphone? You want a microphone? Or do you want a screen? Right there.
I don't need it. Did the flyer actually get you in?
No.
And when it said it would get you in, it was lying.
And also, how did you pay with the $100 bill that got you in? How did you, most of them are like the old rock concert posters, and they don't have years. I mean, I noticed a bunch of years, but most of them probably didn't have years. How did you sort them when you were doing the book?
Well, most of them had the date and day of the week, so I would just go into iCal and figure out. And I kind of knew basically when these were from. Actually, funny enough, the only flyer in the entire book, which we can't identify the year of, is Grace Jones, New Year's Eve. I know you do, that's why it's here.
That's 2 years. That overlapped 2 years.
We let the party people see you. Boom, boom.
Yeah, this was the best event I ever went to. I hired Grace Jones, paid her $60,000. I wanted to put her on at 1 o'clock, so I told her she had to go on at 11. And we sold out completely, totally, absolutely. We had an ad in the Village Voice this big, and we handed out about 10,000 of those. And we were charging $200 for dinner, and I think it was $60 to get in. Something like that, and we completely sold Red Zone.
What year, approximately? 92?
See, they locked me up in, I'd say 1990.
90, okay.
Like that.
Yeah, I'm sure.
1990, right? You were mad? Why are you mad? It was unbelievable. Unbelievable. But I actually almost got killed because I put her on, and the powers that be didn't like the idea that I had booked her. And there was a war backstage which got very violent. But she went on, the show went on, and nobody knew what happened.
Isn't there video of that?
I'm not sure.
The war, I mean the performance.
Of what?
Not the war backstage, I mean the performance. Isn't there?
I don't know.
I think there's YouTube footage of it.
Any questions? Someone else?
What do you guys want to see from artists today in self-promotion? Like, what do you think is missing in that way? You guys had such, like, a style with it.
Like, you guys had such style with it and, you know, your innovation. Like, what do you think is missing in today's society with, like, artists being independent, promoting themselves? Like,
that's a huge question.
That's a separate panel.
Yeah, there's still tons of creativity around. It's just a different time.
Talk to DB after the panel. Give me some tips.
How you doing, panel? How's everybody? I remember sneaking into the clubs in the 90s. Limelight was actually one of the clubs I snuck into, I'm sorry. But Limelight was one of the clubs I snuck into, one of the best clubs. But the music then in the 90s and the music in the, I imagine, in the 80s was, it seemed like a lot better. The hunger, the creativity was different then. Do you guys notice a difference when you hear music now? Like, do you feel like, oh man, like in the 90s, they would have crushed this person, or in the 80s, they would have done this better, versus the music that's coming out now is the hunger, the creativity, the style, the fun different.
You have to get out of Manhattan, man.
The reason why the music is the way it is because of you. If you accept the bullshit, you're gonna hear the bullshit. So, if you have an artist that keeps making records that are microwavable and you're accepting it, it's because you like to swipe instead of listen. If you listen, you might realize you don't like what you hear, so you stop listening. And when you stop listening, they go away. And you hear the good shit.
Yeah,
hey Stretch. Well, y'all, I've been to the parties that y'all throw, the at Cielo, and I love it. But will all of y'all come back together and do something? Will y'all like make it poppin' for my generation? Because I don't go out unless Stretch is DJ, and that's real. So can y'all come together and like make it happen again, or is that?
This would be the most schizophrenic party ever. That could be good.
I think it's time to bring it back.
Let's do it. I'm down.
I'm just putting it out there.
What's your birthday?
April 28th.
That's a really good idea. It's a really good idea. It's a good idea.
But
Jessica Rosenblum probably doesn't want us next to her too much anymore. How stressful we've all been to her, and how stressful she's been to all of us. Nah, I'm actually joking, but if anybody could do it, those three in the middle definitely could do it.
Well, I'm just saying.
We'll talk.
I just want to say that me and Stretch will DJ. Okay, so we'll DJ the party.
As it should be.
Since we're asking these three who have to be the promoters for this fabulous party that we're going to have, how do you spend your days now?
Well, up until very recently, I still did management and represented a large amount of DJs and produced a lot of private events and still promoted. So my day was sort of a mishmash of managing all those three activities. I no longer do management and only produce a few private events a year. And I actually took, and I'm working on a project. And in the meantime, I took an actual job full circle. And I am back 30 years later, running the door at an exclusive club.
Okay, this time, she's not gonna let us.
I'm definitely not letting anybody.
Yeah, I'm not gonna get that one either.
I mean, for me, I was working in the clubs up until about 3-4 years ago. I still do it occasionally. I consult with clubs. I mean, and then I'm trying to figure out what's next. Do I want to live here? Do I want to live somewhere else? Do I want to come full force? neurotic Jewish stuff.
And we go to lunch and kvetch.
I'm a hospitality designer now. I'm designing a restaurant on the Lower East Side. I've designed about 100 places, maybe 200, I can't keep track. I write for Black Book Magazine, a column called Good Night, Mr. Lewis. And I'm a newlywed, and I spend every ceremony with my wonderful wife. And I always have things to do. I still have the nightlife, but I do know that come 11 o'clock at night, I'm thinking about bed. Because I'm 64 years old, I survived. I'm on my third of five marriages. And I hope she's not seeing this.
Who's really got a good one? I mean, just...
Yeah, so my name is Shikori Shar. I run a non-profit organization for youngsters who are at risk. And on the time I spend with them, it's really heartbreaking that they don't know the names of the people on this panel. And one of them is a really popular DJ at the university he goes to, and he's never heard of DJ Clark Kent.
That's a good thing.
So my hats off for that. Any suggestions on how some of these youngsters can
buy the book?
There are a number of them. Our book is one. There's a book that Paradise. Formerly of X-Clan, just published, called No Half-Steppin'. It's a visual and oral history of the Latin Quarter, which is bananas by that.
This thing that we were a part of for the past 40 years called hip-hop is probably the only culture that doesn't cultivate itself. If you ask a brand new rock and roll artist what's the third song on Aerosmith's second album, they'll tell you the song, the writers, and the producer. If you ask a new rapper what's the first song on Run DMC's second album, they'll ask you who's Run DMC. It's not the fault of the kid. It's the fault of the people before the kid who won't teach the kid. So him not knowing about me, it's not my fault. I'm out here and I'm doing it. It's the people who are in the middle who really, really don't care about the actual culture of hip hop. All they care about is rap music. So they're not teaching the culture to the kids who's growing up within the culture. So they're lost, unfortunately.
Hello again. I'm Wendy Escobar. I didn't introduce myself before. I have another question. You mentioned briefly, Bill, back in the green room that you got kicked out for handing out flyers inside clubs. So you guys spoke about mailing flyers out. Can you speak a little bit more about distribution face-to-face?
I mean, for me, I went and did it. I mean, I paid people, I had people in front of every club when I was doing a big party, say with Steve or Jess, when I was doing a much smaller thing, I did it, me and my two partners. We gave them all the flyers out. But we also took a graffiti approach to it. I wheat pasted, I put up stickers, we straight up wrote graffiti on walls, buildings, letting people know where the cube is and ask the place. We did whole wheat paste, the whole wall, announcing, come find our parties.
And at any given sort of, there would be, you know, for these 3 months, or these 6 months, these X number of stores are cool, and they let you lead flyers at them. So you would have your teams go out and they would have a list of places to go drop the flyers off, and you would leave stacks at every store. And when I started, you know, there were the downtown stores, but then also we'd go uptown, we'd go to 125 Mart in Harlem, passing them out. I mean, there were just so many different places that I know that would, you know, allow it. And it, you knew that the sort of people who frequented the store sort of represented the clients you wanted at the party, and it was the same thing, that the store was willing to have a shelf and have a variety of flyers. It was fun to go in the stores, and you'd see the shelf of all these different flyers sitting there. It was a thing to go check out.
by the time I got to NASA, we had a team of kids that just wanted to promote for us because A, it meant they could get in, and B, the, you know, the flyers themselves were really cool, so they put them around and we would, five bars, you know, go everywhere.
This is a little private conversation going on here.
Tom Billy was really nervous in front of all these people. I told him he did good.
Is Clark Kent ready? No? I think we're wrapping up the panel.
Well, I'm not done.
Anyway, hey everyone, you guys all right? We're good?